beautiful San Francisco.
Opened a Starbucks in my living room. So, thank you. Yeah, I feel the same way. Just roll out of bed and there you are. But the thing is, I still don't have the Starbucks protocol right. You know, like I go in and I think, okay, I'm going to order, I'm going to get it right this time. I will have the non-fat grande hazelnut latte, and in their passive-aggressive way, when they reorder for me, it is the grande hazelnut non-fat latte. And every day I go in, I'm going to get it right this time, I'm going to get it right. I'm like, what do I have diarrhea? I'm going to get it. And I'm always wrong. So you're asking me, why do you go to the Bennigan's of coffee? Why do you go there? Why do you go to like the Polish and Shine Polite coffee? Why not Java or Insomnia or Ground Zero where the hipsters go? I'll tell you why I can't go there anymore. Because I went to see Weezer recently and I had to leave because it was too loud. I left Weezer because it was too loud. So now, shamefacedly, I go to Starbucks with all the people my age. Getting their coffee. Don't get me wrong, I like Weezer a lot. So anyway, I'm going to do some impressions. Do you mind? Do some impressions for you. Okay, here's some impressions for you. Here's my first impression. Here's my impression of someone watching the latest Mentos candy ad. Alright, latest Mentos ad, watching it. What the fuck are they? Is that kind of mannequin or? Are these German? I don't know. Wait, there's more! Here's my impression of somebody watching Kathleen Turner being interviewed recently. The fuck, is she German? No. She has some kind of accent now that is like Germanic, Teutonic. We don't know where Kathleen's from, but all the more exotic and therefore castable. Okay. So I was thinking for the Mentos thing, they've really missed the boat though. I've got some new ideas for the Mentos candy tablet. Das Freshmacher. For Mentos, what do you think? Like a KKK rally? Or maybe a guy trying to get to a gay pride parade? Or an Asian sweatshop? Just all you need is a headband. That's all you need. Okay. Okay, here's my impression of every movie trailer that you go see in a theater when you go see previews. In a world. Okay, that's it. It's always in a world and then, or in a town. And then Tommy Lee Jones will do something. Unless, of course, you're in San Francisco and you watch a movie trailer of some kind, inevitably somebody will go, because in San Francisco you have to hiss something. Okay. See, I have a piece of paper. Don't mind me. I am a professional, but I have a lot of NutraSweet in my system. I don't have a good short-term memory. I have a lot of, you know, things I want to discuss with you. I don't even remember what they are. I have them on a piece of paper. Don't mind me. If I glance over, it's not because I don't care. It's because I can't remember anything. Okay. I saw The Perez Family recently, that movie The Perez Family, and I really, really liked it. Don't hiss me. Is anybody hissing or did I say hiss me? You don't even know why you're hissing. San Francisco, and I applaud that. Go ahead, hiss. But I saw The Bryce Family. I really enjoyed it. I like Marinara's director. She's very good. She throws a lot of curveballs. I like that. Marissa Tomei was in that movie, and she gained 20 pounds for the movie. Big hoo-ha, 20 pounds. So she was like tipping the scales at 120 when she did that movie. It's like this big deal. She gained 20 pounds for the movie. You know what? I'm an actor, and I keep the 20 all the time. I've got it right here. I'm ready to work. It's right here. I don't know what to do with you. You cannot keep applying. And I know it makes me look good, but I don't know how to handle you. So anyway, about the 20 pounds. I'll tell you what. It's not easy to keep it on. You know, where's my kudos from Siskel and Ebert? Where's my doff of the cap from Rex Reed? Because, you know, you think Jesus can keep it on. I'll tell you what. I pay a trainer a lot of money to come to my house. Every night he comes over. And after dinner, he makes me drink vodka tonics, and watch a little TV, and then a few bowls of cereal and right to bed. And I make no apologies. I make no apologies. Camera adds 10 pounds. You hear that theory? Camera adds 10 pounds. It's not a theory. It's a fact. Camera does add 10 pounds to anyone when they work, and apparently we don't have the technology to conquer that little aberration there. We can have Gump cavorting with dead presidents in a Jurassic summer, but we just don't, we don't get that 10-pound thing. I don't, what? Guys, ILM, you know, George Lucas is the nerds, and they're like, and we have a substance now that is very similar to if a volcano erupts in theater, there will be a substance that's not unlike cotton candy that will be running down the aisles, and you'll be able to touch it, but when you touch it, it will disappear. But the 10-pound thing, we don't understand. And so yeah, that was that. Dave Matthews Band and Hootie and the Blowfish. I gotta bring it up. Seem like nice guys. Seemingly very nice guys. But never has a CD purchase spoke more volumes about a person in their life. Hootie and Dave Matthews Band. I know who you are. I know who you are. You're not an evil person. You're not a lawbreaker. You don't rock as a rule. But when you do, it's in a very VH1 kind of way. VH Hootie. And you like the show Friends a lot. A lot. You wish that Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan could star every movie. Every movie. But not just as a loving couple, but as a functionally retarded couple. That would just say little nuggets of wisdom we could put on a mug, maybe, or a bumper sticker. So I got the club for my car. I got the club. And which is nice because I have an airbag on the steering wheel, so the club leans on it and the horn goes off, which is good at 2 a.m. So I'm alerting all malcontents and ne'er-do-wells that I'm home and I'm alone and it's dark. And so I got mugged. And they got my knapsack with my comedy notebook in it. So if anybody sees two cholos bombing at the Funny Bone chain, that would be them. And if you can just give me a jingle, that'd be good. So I got mugged and I was thinking, wouldn't it be great if, you know, in the animal kingdom, all the animals have, like, devices to protect themselves, predator, prey, the whole thing. Wouldn't it be great if humans, law-abiding humans, had little, like, devices that protected them, like, evolutionarily developed bio, that's a good prefix, right? Bio something, biological imperatives that saved you. Like, I'm coming out of my car, and a mugger's coming towards me, and then all of a sudden it would be like, see, it's Janeane blends with the Geo Metro. Become one with the Geo Metro, and the mugger would go, what? And then move on. That'd be good. And then, okay, so I lost the Geo Metro, and I got a Ford Ranger, and, because it was ready. I have no use for a pickup, none. I have no, the only reason I have a Ford Ranger XLT is because it was ready. And I drove it off the lot. And I'm incredibly lazy. I have a very can you start my orange approach to life. I don't haggle with salesmen for cars. I don't get better deals on things. I don't know. I'm a straight C student. I don't know. I've never in my life uttered the phrase, you're going to be extra credit on this, because I would never, I don't do that. I don't know anything about that way of life, and I have no kind of stick to it. In fact, I've only stuck to one thing in my life. I started doing stand-up in 1985. I've only stuck to the entertainment industry because only that can provide me with the sheer depression and self-loathing. That's the only thing that, the misery, that's the only thing that can fill that void of hatred. So I've stuck with that. But, so I got the Ford Ranger and I was making out with my boyfriend in the front seat of the Ford Ranger and I thought, what the fuck? I'm 30. What? Making out, and I have this unparalleled fear of intimacy. It's just bizarre. I mean, I'm not going to go into it now because I'm on stage with a mic, but I'm just saying that it's very odd, and I only like people that don't seem to like me, and blah, 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 and I can't respect people that really like me, and the whole nine, you know. So I'm making out with the Ford Ranger. I said, you know, I'm not the only one, though. It seems that there's, like, a generation of people that have this weird fear of intimacy, and they don't get married, and they're in their late 30s, and they should just aim the car for the demographic and have like the Ford Ranger fear of intimacy cab. And it's like just enough room to really make out but not have sex. It like inhibits your range of motion just that much. And like their tagline would be, well, you don't want to bring it indoors because it's too weird. When you can't go to his house and he doesn't want to come to yours. That whole thing. You're making out. But then sometimes y'all get drunk enough and somebody actually does have sex with me inside. You know, that does happen occasionally where I'm in one of those, you know, when you're drunk and you're weirdly optimistic. And like things are fine for some weird reason. And then the booze patrol comes over and gives you an award. But, you know, there's been times when I have actually had sex indoors and I become, it's weird because then you kind of sober up this little when it's over, you know, and I become like a bartender at 2 a.m. It's like, okay, people, let's move it out. Yeah, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Go. Out. Out. And it's like such an odd checkoff play, you know, like when I decide I don't want to see them, that they really like me, you know, they wanted to leave until I say I want them to leave, and then, you know what I'm talking about. So I was talking about, and you know what's weird about, okay, this might be too much, I might be pushing the envelope, but, like, have you ever been, like, having sex with someone and you just want to fucking punch them in the face? It's so weird. I have to really investigate that, but I just want to punch them in the face. Just stop it! Stop fucking me! Oh, you're going to get a knuckle sandwich for that one. And then frequently when I drink, you know, I feel bad about it the next day. I feel so bad about it. I wake up, the first thing, my eyes pop open in the morning and I get on the phone. What did I say? Who did I make out with? Why do these muscles hurt? What? Did I say anything to you? Did I do anything? Was I impolite in any way? You know, I have like this phone tree of people I call for weird reasons. And sometimes I pace at night in my old apartment. I pace, you know, and I smoke and I chastise myself for whatever I've done wrong and, you know, whatever. And, you know, in my apartment, my old apartment, the walls are so thin that I can literally hear my neighbor doing this. Like, I can hear him doing that or going, like, I can hear him do that. So he can hear me talking. And then one day we're getting our mail and he goes, I heard you fighting with your boyfriend again last night. You're so mean to him. Never be that mean to anyone else. I'm talking to myself. So, I should just wear a hair shirt all day. That's what SNL was for me. It was a hair shirt. It was a giant hair shirt. SNL to me, and I had a lot of great experiences there. God bless them, you know. But SNL to me was this whole experience. This is how I encapsulate it. I feel like the Native American who accepted the pox-infested blankets from the U.S. Cavalry. For me? Thank you! I don't feel so good. That's that's what that experience was. Although, you know, there was some good things out of it. I got to meet Alec Baldwin, who, I gotta say, Alec Baldwin is the closest thing to James Bond you're gonna find in this mortal coil. I swear to God. Unbelievably great guy. Unbelievably funny and handsome and, like, Johnny on the spot. You know, I had a cigarette, he had a lighter. Lozenge. You know, he was like, right on the money. And I got to meet George Clooney. And I know, all right, trite, George Clooney crush. So what? You know what? ER, they got me. I'm not made of wood, people. I'm not made of wood. They got me. That's a writer's construct. The pediatrician, blah, blah, blah. It's trouble with women. He's haggard, blah, blah. Yeah, all right. You win, uncle. You got me. I like him. And Caruso from NYPD Blue, that guy who's a cop, when they wear the trench coat with the loosened tie, fuck. And, like, you know, the big thing now is the cops with the thing on the necklace. That's a biggie. In the movies, they don't wear badges anymore here. They wear them on the necklace. Oh, and here's a Valentine's card. This goes with my Ford Ranger thing. I have no concept of linear keeping jokes together. I don't know anything about that, but it would be my Valentine's card that I think I'm going to send my boyfriend. Things have been going so well thus far, I will find more ways to become unavailable to you. Okay, I hate high fashion. I hate it. I hate supermodels as a celebrity. I hate the fact that we reward people for being genetic freaks. I really do. I think it's awful. I just think it's abominable that, we have, you know, the crisis of confidence that hits 13, 14-year-old girls when they go through, it's just a crime. Reviving Ophelia Reedick's good book. 14 million eating disorders in this country. It makes me sick. It makes me sick the way women are the victims of lookism, and that high fashion just feeds into coveting and vanity and all that is evil. And I hate them. I will not back down on this. I don't care how unlikable it makes me seem to you. I hate it. I hate models in general. And oh, when even female journalists will say, Cindy Crawford, one of the bigger models. Fuck you! Fuck you! Shut up! I hate you, know you're lying, and shut up! You know, and when there is statistics, you know, and then 5'10", 120, fuck you. I hate you, and stop making me feel bad about the way I look about myself. Stop at TV and stop at movies, and until as women we all say no, we're not going to stop ourselves, that's going to change. So we're all worst enemies a lot of times, but I still blame men. But, such an eyesore when I land at LAX that, I mean, here I'm fine, but there, and they can kiss my fat ass, I swear to God. And I won't lose the weight, I promise you this in my career, I promise you, because that would be a sellout, but I'm lazy too, yes, but I'm very noble as well. But I hate e-fashion files so much. And they have these runway shows, and then they have a commentator going, return to glamour this season. A pretty face is your best asset this season. As opposed to last season, when ugly girls had a free ride all the way through. When backpack was all the rage. And by the way, I did star in the movie Back Fat, directed by Ron Howard. But then Billy Baldwin signed on, they changed, they put fire in or something. But I used to be the star of the movie Back Fat. And I can't believe you have pictures of me on your t-shirt. HBO. This man was here at 3:30 when I got here. And I'm half going, I'm half flat and half scared. That's the thing. So if you are a potential stalker, I think it's good that we make friends. That's why I brought him up. See? See, you've all seen him, so if something happens to me, you've all seen him. The most important thing, and you'll be good with stalkers. Thank you for bringing it up. Again, with the evolutionarily developed things, it goes back to my car. I'll bring this, somehow I will get a tight set somewhere, but wouldn't it be good if people's body language were indicative of their motives? Like, if he were in fact a stalker, he would walk like this. And then I would know. So I gotta ask, how uncool is David Copperfield? Because David Copperfield is really under the impression that he's incredibly cool. That has blown my mind. He's so blown, don't look into my eyes. It's just... And he's with Claudia Schiffer, which is so much that... You know who Claudia Schiffer's favorite band is? Foreigner. Isn't that just the way? But you know what? So what? She's so... So what? She's still the most popular. So what? She likes Foreigner. Thanks for hissing. So I was walking out of the Beverly Center in Los Angeles, which is this big shopping center. In fact, I'm going to have my name changed to Beverly Center. Beverly Center. And I was walking out of the Beverly Center, and I was walking to my car, and there was a dad and his, like, three-year-old son walking to their car. And then I was, like, walking here, and then there was a, empirically speaking, attractive blonde walking near me. And I'm not, you know what, I sound like a woman slammer. I don't mean that at all. I hope I haven't come across as that at all. I'm so down with my gender that it's unbelievable. So I hope I haven't at all painted that picture. But this blonde who was not down with the cause, because she goes to a gym. Anyway, I feel that way. If you go to the gym and stuff, you're not on my side. You're not. I really believe that. I believe it because I just do it for me because it makes me feel good. You're a liar. You're lying. No one gets on a Stairmaster because, oh, it's just for me. It's a lie. And you know what I think though with a Stairmaster? There's one good thing for a Stairmaster. Okay, you know how like when you wake up in the morning and you like hit your, clock radio for 10 more minutes. Now, if we could hit the snooze line, if we could meld like a Stairmaster and a snooze line, because Stairmaster time is the slowest increment of time known to man. So if you get like 10 minutes on Stairmaster, it really does feel like 2 hours. If you get that with your clock radio and you hit the snooze bar with the Stairmaster, I'm not really making myself clear, but if you could meld the two, it would be like this 10 minutes of eternity. So anyway, so I was walking out to my car, and this blonde was walking out to her car, and the dad ogles the blonde, and she was like so trite, you know, she had like the Levi's hiked up, cinch at the waist, black belt, black cover boots, V-neck, Hanes t-shirt, I know I'm wearing one too, but whatever, but not in the same way. She had one on tucked in, and the crispy bangs, kind of crispy, and long blonde hair, walk, blah, blah, blah. And so the dad was ogling her, and I was walking near her, and I thought, God, that is such a bad woman. At least ogle me. Take the road less traveled. Give your son something to grow on, you know? I'm not a lesbian. I look like a lesbian, but no. It's different. And give your son something. And, you know, that look is so, and you know, that it speaks volumes about the guy and about the girl. That is as unoriginal as a fucking snowball fight. That's how unoriginal that look is to me. Like snowball fights, you know, like I used to live in New York and the first snow and the couples would tumble out of the bar and throw a snowball. And all that's for, because they don't really know each other, but they're floating around. All that snowball fight is for, look how whimsical I am. Fuck me. Look at, I'm whimsical. I'm whimsical. You ever watch that show, Supermarket Sweep? I gotta say, I'm very much anti-marriage and anti-children because I think it's, you know, I'm screwed up. I'm not gonna pretend to dress it up in a noble construct of, but I'm against it for this reason. I'm screwed up. I'll own that. But I see Supermarket Sweep, and I'm envious in a weird way. Because those are couples that work together. You know what I mean? That's a couple. Right there. You know, they dress alike. And do you know what I'm talking about? You see on Lifetime, the Woman's Channel on Supermarket Sweep. Now that's a couple, man. You know what I mean? Like, they thought about it before they went in. They put on the same shirt. And they made a list of where the most cost-effective products are. Like, the meats are here. and maybe the sundries are here, but we're going to do this together. Do you know what I mean? They just, I mean, that's a Hootie fan, too. Bit of a notch, a lateral from a Hootie. That's not even really a Hootie fan, is it? Really? They're not even maybe VH1ers, are they? Somehow, perhaps, Enya got in. But not even maybe a Hootie fan. But that's a couple that works together. And I enjoy it. Maybe they go line dancing. Maybe they watch TNN's White Horse Cafe line dancing. I do, because I am just, there's a little piece of me, there's a little piece in this cynic that is somewhat envious of people that don't give a fuck about what goes in their ear hole, eye hole, mouth hole, whatever. We accept anything. Who's ever in office as a president? I don't give a damn. Rush Limbaugh? Yeah, he's funny. I don't care. I don't care. Ask to watch Denim? Sure. I just want to have kids. I don't want to rock the boat. That's all I want to do. Lion King? Absolutely. Soundtrack? Yes. I think I covered it all. Starbucks, Weezer, Mentos, Kathleen Turner. Did I talk about Speed yet, the movie Speed? Alright, this will be my last thing. Okay, this will be it. Because I have cable in my hotel room and I saw the movie Speed. Highly implausible. I don't buy it. The bus actually stopped for Sandra Bullock when she was running after it. I don't buy it. The rest of it, yes, but not the part where Sam, the bus driver, so she knew Sam. Sam, the bus driver, that. And, you know, they should just have go the whole nine. You know what I mean? Like, they were so trite in their portrayal of the movie, and everybody's sitting on the bus. They had every stereotype on the bus, the construction worker. Why not just go the whole nine and have, like, Eskimo with a harpoon sitting back there? Indian, full headdress, you know. Shifty-eyed gangster, pinstripe suit, fingering a violin case. Why not?